Welcome back to the next PIC10F200 basic microcontroller tutorial. This is going to be the first time we actually load a program on there and turn on an LED. So I don't know if you know, but in the embedded world, if you come from the computer science programming world, turning on an LED and making it blink is kind of the hello world equivalent of doing something in C or Java or whatever. But since we're not gonna make it blink this time, we're just gonna call it the hello program. Let's get started. If you did the last tutorial, you should be set up. You should have your project and a main.asm file ready to go in your MPLAB IDE, and your circuit should be all set up, and your PICket or ICD or whatever you're using should all be connected. And all we should need to do now is load in the program and upload it. With all of that, if you want to grab the code either from our website, circuitbread.com, or we're going to flash this code up on screen, either way, I recommend that you actually type in this code line by line because it'll make it stick in your head a little bit better. But I am going to go over it line by line, so do whatever feels natural for you. So first, let's get into assembly. Assembly is made up of basically four different parts. So first you have labels, which is just something you put in there and it labels a section of the code. And it's partially for you to understand what's going on and for you to know what your particular sections are doing. It's also useful for the code itself because you can reference it within the code. And we'll get to that not in this program, but in the next program. The other thing is mnemonics, which are also known as operational code, opcode, or instructions. Now, mnemonics is a way where you take a word and you shorten it up and you use the first letters to make it represent something, and you'll see why that is, because there are certain codes here that, for example, decrement, file register, skip if zero, you don't want to type that out every single time, so they came up with a shortened code so that you can type that in, you know what it means, it actually has some sort of meaning to you, but it's not this great, long, crazy thing that you have to type in every single time. I like to refer to them as instructions because to me that is more intuitively what they are. They're instructions that tell the microcontroller what to do, but you can hear them as opcode or mnemonics or whatever. The third thing is operands, or basically the parameters that you give your opcode or your instructions. And so when you have an instruction, it's saying you're typically wanting to move something or to calculate something. That thing that you're going to want to move or calculate is going to be different every time. And so with that different parameter or operand, that's how you make that opcode or instruction do exactly what you want to do. So that's the third thing you need to worry about. The fourth thing is comments. Now, comments are super easy because that is purely something for you or whoever is going to be looking at your code to be better able to understand what your code is trying to do. I don't know about you, but if you've ever written code and think, man, this is perfectly clear, and then for some reason you don't touch it again for 6 months to a year, and you come back and you look at it and you think, what in the world was I doing here? Comments, in my experience, help. Don't make it completely clear, but at least help. So kind of, okay, this is what we want to do. So using an IDE is very beneficial. In reality, you could do all of this coding in a text editor or something and create the make file and do everything in the command line, and it could be much more customizable and it'll be exactly what you want. But that is pretty challenging. I've done that in the past and I learned a ton, but it is very nice to have an IDE that creates the infrastructure around it and simplifies a lot of things. Though if you do it manually, it does help you understand when there are problems in the IDE. And I bring this up in particular because if you look at the code, you can see that different things are different colors. You notice everything after a semicolon is a comment, and it's actually in green. And that helps give you more subtle clues when you're looking at something. First of all, what it does, and second of all, if it's not the right color, it gives you an intuitive, like, wow, something's wrong here. Oh, I put a colon instead of a semicolon. Those sorts of things. So let's look at this code. It's only 11 lines. We should be able to go through it pretty quick, and then we're gonna load this up, and then we're gonna be done, and then next time, we're gonna start making that LED blink. But first, let's go through this line by line. So the first thing we see on the first line is pound include, and then in quotes, P10F200.inc. So basically what this is doing is this is telling the IDE and the compiler that there are certain things that have already been predefined to make your life easier. As you go through, you'll see references to GP1, and you'll see config and all of these sort of things, where that would mean absolutely nothing if it weren't for the fact that somebody already went in and said, hey, if you're working with a P10F200, then you have three GPIOs and one input. So when somebody says GP1, that means they're referring to this particular pin, and that makes it a lot easier for you to just throw in some things instead of having to go to the data sheet and see, okay, GP1 is this bit, in this register, so that means I need to do this, and it really simplifies things. And also, it's one of those things where if you say, hey, I want to send something to GP5, this knows, hey, the P10F200 doesn't have 5 GPIOs, so what are you talking about? And it'll throw up errors to tell you, hey, this isn't something you can actually use. So that's important. If you don't have that, it's not gonna work. And the second line is just a comment. Says, okay, now we're gonna do the configuration. Third line, you have those double underscores config, and what it's telling you here is you need to set up the microcontroller in some ways, and none of this is absolutely necessary for our current setup, but because we didn't wanna have to worry about the watchdog timer or code protection or anything like that, we configured this so the watchdog timer is off. Otherwise, it'll reset itself every once in a while, and we'll get into watchdog timers later. But we also don't need the code protection because we're turning on an LED. There's nothing to protect here. And then the MClear off, that just means that we can use that pin that has MClear for a GPIO if we want, and we won't use that as a reset pin. So on line 4 is kind of interesting. Whenever I see ORG, I think organization, something like that, but that actually means origin. So what we're saying is that we are now at the beginning of the program that is actually going to be executed. So here is where we start. Number 5, this is where we see our first label. So init or initialization. This is basically telling us as ourselves, it's almost like a comment in a way, that this is where we're going to get the microcontroller set up, ready to go. Number 6, this is the most complicated line in the entire program here. The first time I saw something set up like this, I just had no idea what was going on. Like, what's the tilde? What's the one? I just didn't know. So first, let's break this into two parts. So the move LW is our first mnemonic or first opcode that we need to worry about. And that is move literal to W. W is our working register, as we've talked about in a previous tutorial. And the strange thing about assembly is you can't just say, I want to multiply this by this, or I want to do this. You have to take one number, stick it in the working register, and then you can take that working register and multiply it or deal with it with other registers. For example, if you do want to multiply something, multiply this register by that register, but you need to take one of those and put it into the working register first. So what this move LW is taking a literal, or the number that you give it as the operand, and puts it into the working register. Now, the operand in this case, the parameter, is that tilde 1 and then the 2 less than signs and then GP1. Now, as I mentioned, GP1 is given to us as a specific code. It's how the compiler knows exactly where, which bit to move. So in this case, just happens to be that GP1 is in bit 1. So when you go from 0 to 7 in the GPIO register, it is bit 1. It's saying, let's put a 1 in this register, let's shift that register over the amount of spaces where you need to go to fill that GP1 bit, and then let's take all of that and knot it. And that makes it so instead of being a bunch of zeros, 1, 0, it's a bunch of 1s and 0, 1. Let's go over that really quick again. So the tilde, if you're not familiar with bitwise operations, takes all 1s, turns them to 0s, and all 0s and turns them to 1. And then that left shift with that double less than sign takes whatever you have and shifts it to the left. What we're doing here is we are simply putting a 1 in at the very right hand side, shifting it to the left enough so that it fills that GP1 slot, and then inverting them all. With this, you can look at it and intuitively know, oh, I want to put a 0 at GP1 and leave everything else as 1s. So even though this may be a lot more complicated originally, once you get used to it and it's more intuitive, it's going to be a lot easier to do. So in line 7, you have TRIST GPIO. Now this is an instruction that it always takes GPIO as an operand. And TRIST stands for tri-state, so that refers to the fact that it can be a high voltage, a low voltage, or it can be a high impedance. Those are the three states that a pin can take. And so in this case, what it's doing is it's saying, take the value that is in the W register that we just put in there from the previous state and load that in here into the GPIO register. And so we set that. And so that's how we can say of all of these things, GP1 is going to be an output because it is a 0 and we're good to go. Line 8, we have BSF. This is our next mnemonic, which that stands for bit set F. So as we know, a set bit makes a pin high and a cleared bit makes a pin low. And so as we do this, we take bit set F and GPIO, take that register and bit GP1 and set it. So the two operands are GPIO, which again is the register, and GP1, which is the bit within that register, and set that particular bit in that particular register. And that is the actual line that turns on our LED. The following three lines are really simple. So loop in line 9, that just is another label. And then number 10, it's go to loop. So you will learn in any programming class that in C, C++, Java, Python, whatever, go to is terrible. You never want to use it. It's going to cause all sorts of problems. In assembly, that's not the case. You use go to quite a bit. And in this case, go to loop just basically tells the program that once you hit that line 10, to go back to the label of loop, which is line 9. And it's going to do that. It's going to go, oh, go to line 9. Oh, go to line 9. And it's going to do that forever and ever and ever and ever, because that's all we want is we turn on the LED, now we're done. Line 11 just says end, and that's just a way for the program to know this is the end of the code and it's done. And if you don't have that, you're going to have some sort of error. So that's it. That's probably going to be pretty fast, and I'm hoping those explanations will help you get a better intuitive feel. Highly recommend going back and reading the actual tutorial on our website, because then you're going to have a little bit more time to read through it and let it absorb. And don't worry if it takes two or three times through for all of these things to make sense. But now that we have this set up, let's load this up. So as you may have noticed, I'm actually on the MPLAB Xpress. I'm on the online IDE. And this is because macOS decided that it wanted to update, and I didn't think twice about it. And in so doing, it broke MPLAB X IDE. And so now it is a real pain, but I'm going to show you approximately how you're going to do it in MPLAB Xpress, and hopefully they'll fix it in the real MPLAB IDE so that we don't have to go through this every time. But typically you just come up and there's this button right here, and it shows the box and an arrow down to the microcontroller. You hit that button and it not only builds it, but then it automatically programs it. And if you've done everything successfully, then it just goes. But because this is being a pain, it just built it and saved it as a hex file. And then I had to download MPLAB IPE, go in here, and now I need to connect, and that's going to take a minute. See, all of these things that I'm doing in the IPE, the integrated programming environment, are actually done inside of the IDE. So I don't care about that. See, now it's connected. Oh, and it doesn't save your settings either. What a pain. There we go. Let's switch over to power really quick. Power target from PIC. Go back to operate, try and connect again. So again, it's much simpler when everything's working through the IDE, but if for some reason something doesn't work and MPLAB decides it doesn't want to work, you can switch it over to the online version and then build your file there and upload it here manually. It's just a bigger pain. So let's browse our download. So primero, there we go. And then we click program. Again, all of these things are done automatically in the IDE if everything's done properly and everything's set up properly. So that makes it super easy. Now we're done. So all of that work, all of that explanation, and those 11 lines of code, getting through, building it, uploading it on the IPE, and now we have this beautiful, shiny, green LED. Now, this is a wonderful moment, and this is just the first of many, many projects that you can do, and this is our Hello program. Hello, we are working, we are able to put the code in, build it, download it, and have it actually do what we wanted to do. So do not think that this is not important, because this is important. And I hope that this is something that has been really helpful for you. I hope this is getting you really excited for the future projects we're going to be doing, because we've got a lot of cool stuff coming down the pipeline. If you did like this, give this video a like. Go to our website to get more information, circuitbread.com, and you can see all this code and a little bit more in how to do this. Leave a comment if you have any questions, subscribe to our channel, and we'll catch you on the next tutorial.